For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.
First Timothy, 2 Thessalonians, here we are. We're in the last chapter of this book that we have been studying. And we're in verse 12. On your paper, I said we talked about this last Sunday, and then it dawned on me that was 1:17 when I gave fight the good fight of faith. We got snowed, right? People get snowed, don't go to church. We were snowed. Well, anyhow, here we are. We're back to this text, and we're going to look at the second part because fight the good fight of faith is an imperative mood in the Greek language. It's a command. Fight the good fight of faith. It's a command. And not only that, but Paul makes a play on words that's important. He makes a play on fight the good fight of faith, the word fight and fight. Fight the good fight. Fight the good fight. We talked about that last time, what that means. But the word fight that it starts out with is a present middle imperative. That's a command. Then he comes back to a second command in this text. And He says in the second part of this, take hold, that's a command. That's an imperative mood on your paper. It's an aorist middle imperative. Hey, well, wait a minute now. You're missing something. You see, when he said fight, he put it in the present tense. But when he said take hold, he put it in the aorist tense. That's a big difference. Take hold of eternal life. That's a command. Take hold of eternal life to which you were called, and you have made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. There's a play on words, and you cannot see it in English. Because the word you made isn't the word you made. It's the word confession. It means confess. It's hamalegeo. Confess the... Actually, what Paul said was confess the good confession. What he literally said was confess the good confession. Just like fight the good fight, he said confess the good confession. And I guess you know what that is. It's eternal life. Take hold of eternal life and give a good confession of the confession of it. Ah. See that? And the fact that he put take hold in the aorist tense throws this into a whole theological idea. And that's where we're going with it this morning, because I'm going to tell you something. A great majority of Christians cannot do this, haven't been willing to do it, take hold of eternal life. They flip-flop. They don't know if they're saved from one day to the next because their salvation concept of keeping or taking hold is works of the law, not grace. It's not on the character of God. It's based on their own character. Let me tell you everything about salvation based on the character of God, not the character of man. That's why Christ went to the cross, because of the character of man. So this is very important, that we understand what he's after, and we should be able to listen. If you're with me today by the internet or here sitting in the pew with me, and you don't have confidence that if you died, you'd go to heaven, this message is for you. If you don't have the confidence, if you don't have the assurance. Listen, I talked to a person the other day that thinks that everybody's going to heaven. Thinks everybody's going to heaven. Everybody who dies is going to heaven. I bet he changed his mind if somebody broke in his house, raped and murdered his daughter. What do you think? I mean, everybody's going to go to heaven. Everybody's going. That's not true. Everybody's going to go somewhere. But God didn't send his son into the world so that you could boycott it, throw it under the bus, and think you're going to go to heaven. That's crazy. That ain't true. Not only that, it's nuts. It's worse than crazy, I guess. All right, let's have a word of prayer, and then we're going to get into this study. Take hold of eternal life. Listen to me. Look up here a moment. You know who he's speaking to? I wrote this down under point one. So glance down on point one, then I'm going to have a prayer with you. You know who he wrote this to? It's a second person singular. Yeah, this is second person singular. He's writing this to Timothy. Do you know who Timothy is? Listen to me. He's speaking to a saved church age believer. Two, he's speaking to a spiritual mature believer. Three, he's commanding him who already has eternal life. And he's commanding Timothy, who's engaged in big time church ministry. Well, there's something to think about. This is who he's commanding, because that second person is singular. So what does it mean when I say to you today, take hold of eternal life? If you don't take hold of eternal life, then you're not going to have the confession of a good confession, because you don't have the confidence of it. When we get done today, we're going to have the confidence so that we can take hold of eternal life, so that we can have a confession of a good confession. And that's going to happen today in this congregation. Let's pray. Al dealt with this principle of you can't study the Bible in carnality, so confession of sin is important. So I'm going to go right to my prayer, because he covered it excellently. So, Father, we're thankful today as we approach you as Spirit-filled people, willing for the Holy Spirit to deal with our souls with the Word of God, to bring us into a self-awareness of the presence of Christ and the importance of our life. No, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Of a conscience that has the awareness of what God pleases God and what does not, and we choose to please you. A mind that is open to the Word of God, to cycle it from hearing to believing to applying the Word of God to our life, so that we can understand what our destiny is. Why am I in the world? What purpose does God have with my life? Wouldn't it be miserable to go through this whole life and never know why we're here? Because the devil has deceived us not to think it's important, and who can know? We can all know if you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. You belong to the family of God. You're on a journey in this life for God, as much as anybody you would read about in the Bible. We have volition, though. We can make our choices and our decisions, and they should be compatible with pleasing God. They ought to be compatible with the will of God. We can't even pray apart from the will of God. Where do we learn that? Out of the Word. We got to stop running on how we feel and what we rather on what we believe. And so we're here today to do that, Father, on the subject matter of taking hold of eternal life, so that we can have the confession of a good confession to others that need to hear it and need to believe it and come to some confidence in their life about it. In Jesus' name. My neighbor across the street from me has been ill for several years. My little three-year-old grandson, when he was home, he's in the garbage business. You have no idea what that means, but he worried about this old man who would carry this big old garbage thing out to the road and leave it, because this old man was really having trouble at heart and all that kind of stuff. And my three-year-old grandson, the fact that he could have been carrying anything else and would have caused attention, but that garbage? Oh, yeah. So Boy, if he heard that old man with that garbage out there, boy, he was to the window and he was hollering for Grandpa and let's get out there and help him. Last night, that old man died. And it was a kind of a sad moment for all of us in our community because we've all lived with him ever since we moved in. There was a group of us all moved in the same time, and we've stayed there while everybody has left. We've stayed. And been wonderful neighbors. But I couldn't help but think as they came and went last night, people, they're church people, they're believers. As Christians do what they do so well in times of trouble, people just came and left and came and left all night long to be with that family. This lesson is about that. It's about taking hold of eternal life in such a way that you have a confession that's a good confession about it to others who this day will come to all of their lives. Other than the rapture, for us as believers, we'll all go through this day and how you do it. And what a joyous time. I mean, you know, when Christians go visit homes, it's like a party. I mean, it's noise and people hugging on each other and laughing and going to the cars and driving off. I thought to myself, isn't that wonderful, Father? Isn't that wonderful? Well, anyhow, the first command, fight the good fight. The second command, take hold. Notice there's a difference. And the aorist tense is kind of an interesting tense in the Greek language. Nothing like it in languages. The Greek is unique in the aorist tense. It's a point in time, divorced from time, that connects it with a past event of something that has occurred in his life previously. When he says take hold and he puts in the aorist tense, it's a point in time when I give you this command, Timothy, it's connected to something that was really important in your past, at a previous point in your past. This point I'm going to tell you now is actually connected to your life in a significant way in the past. And that's the aorist tense of salvation. There was a point in Timothy's life, even though he had been raised in a godly home, when he had to come to grips with the gospel of Jesus Christ. He was a good man, raised by two wonderful women who trained him well in the things of God. And it was because of that that he got God conscious at a very early age. And then when Paul came through, Paul was able to preach the gospel, and he got saved and become part of the Pauline missionary team. It's a wonderful story. Timothy is a wonderful story of a godly home. Just because you live in a godly home don't mean you're saved. It just means you have an advantage to be saved. Timothy was one of those wonderful guys, and he had grew up on the Word of God being taught to him, and it prepared his life to receive Christ as his Savior. So he got saved under Paul's ministry at a point in time, aorist tense. And it was at that time that he got saved, when he heard that Jesus died on the cross for his sins, was buried and raised from the dead the third day. That is the gospel. You will not get to heaven any other way. Jesus came into the world to die for your sins. You say, well, I don't have any. That's all right. Listen, I don't care if you believe you have them or don't have them. You're dead because of Adam's sin. Wherefore, by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. That's why everybody dies at some point in their life, is because of Adam's sin. So I'm not here to pick on your sins. I'm here to pick on the fact that you need to believe that Jesus died for your sin, yours, with your name on it. Your name on it. You've got to subscribe. You want the magazine? You got to put your name and address on it. You got to subscribe to it. You do that by faith. You believe that Jesus died for your sins, was buried and raised from the dead third day. You know why he raised from the dead? Because he went back to heaven. And when you die, you get to go to heaven to be with him. You don't believe it? You don't go to heaven when you die if you don't believe that Jesus did that for you. You know why he's kept you alive all these years? Do you know why you're older than most of the people you grew up with? And why you're the only one that goes to the high school graduation? You're the only one that shows up? You might as well have been homeschooled. All your people are dead. You know why you're still alive? To be sure you got this straight. And listen, why are you squandering your life away? Have you found out why God has you on earth during this period of human history? You could have been born at any time. And why has God still got you? Why are you still hanging around? Doesn't that wonder? Don't you ever wonder about that? I wondered about that when I was a little bitty kid. What will I do with my life? What direction will my life go? Do you know what a pressure it was off me when I found out that God had it already set up for me and I didn't have to make all those decisions, just trust Him with them? Do you know what a burden that was lifted from my life? You know what a burden it is to know that I'm in my destiny? That I'm doing the things that God has planned my life out for? And do you know that I know that I'm in it for the long ride all the way to the end? I don't have to guess about this stuff. I don't have to wonder if I made a right decision or I didn't make a right decision. You know how much pressure that takes off you? Well, that's what I'm talking about here today. That aorist tense of take hold points us back to a point of salvation. At the point of salvation, Timothy, like you and I, received eternal life. Now we're many years later, and he brings his subject up to him because the enemy is attacking that doctrinal principle. And Timothy needs to have a good confession about the confession. I want you to make a confession. I want a confession of a good confession about eternal life. Because people are trying to steal it right out of the church. Don't let them get it out of your church, Timothy. You don't let them steal it out of your church, son. That's what he's talking about here. Listen, he's told to take a hold of something he already has. Eternal life. But he's telling him to do it because he wants to have a confession of a good confession. Homologeo. This is the word homologeo. This is the word confession, like in 1 John 1:9, but used in a different context. Okay. I want to see where we are. Aorist middle, take hold. This is something that's going to benefit him in his ministry, in the church. Church ministry, take hold of it so you can have this confession. And it's a command. It's the imperative mood. Take hold of eternal life to which you were called. That's the salvation connection. And make or confess, homologeo, aorist active indicative, the good confession, that's kalos, that's an intrinsic, or inwardly, that's because you've been born again and have it, bring it out. The confession in the presence of many witnesses. I want you to write this verse down because it's not there, so this is important. You write this verse down because this is what Paul's connected. I want you to write this verse down, then you can look it up. Not now, but later. Listen, what he's talking about, the confession of the good confession that's connected with eternal life and Timothy's salvation, but now is important in his ministry. Are you with me? Come on now. Here it is, Romans 10, 9 and 10. There it is. He says, in verse 10, he says, with the heart man has believed and been justified and now makes confession with his mouth. That's what he's talking about. It's exactly what he's talking about. It's exactly what he's talking about when he talks about the confession of the good confession. It's exactly what he's talking about. Okay, let's look at four things this morning in the first hour. So what's Paul mean by take hold of eternal life to which you were called? He's speaking to a mature believer. He's talking to a pastor of a church. He's talking to a guy who's been on many mission trips. Who has brought many people into the kingdom through the gospel of Christ, now pastoring a group of people. What's he talking about? Paul is commanding Timothy, the young pastor, to take hold of eternal life. Watch this now. Watch these words. Circle them on your paper. To which? Very important words. To which, see that on your paper? Yet Paul is commanding Timothy, take hold of eternal life. To which? See, the word to is ice plus the accusative of purpose. I want you to take hold with this purpose, to which, that's a relative pronoun with eternal life. Take hold of eternal life to which you were called. Say, to which you were called. Now I want you to make a confession, of a good confession about it to others. You see, Timothy has studied and cycled the doctrine of eternal life. He has done this through faith. Now he must fight the good fight over that doctrine. Oh, come on now, listen to me. Write this down. Write it down. Boy, I tell you, I miss a couple weeks and we're... Write down 1 Timothy 1:18 through 20. Because this, he's connected this. He said, fight the good fight of faith. This is where it began in 1 Timothy 1:18 through 20. This is where that subject came up, of fight the good fight of faith. That's where it came up. Now he's wrapping it up. See, he's back to that subject. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of eternal life. Because that's where the enemy... Listen, remember, in 1 Timothy 1:18 through 20, he talks about two guys Timothy went through a seminary with, Hymenaeus and Alexander, who have taken grace and the word of God and the doctrines of grace and thrown them right under the bus, as we say. And he calls them out because Timothy knows them. He said, listen, your buddies, they have shipwrecked their faith, Timothy. Beware that you don't yours. That's what he's talking about. That's exactly what he's talking about. Because the gospel of grace salvation and the package of 50 things you receive at the point of salvation is under enormous attack in the church. And Timothy, Paul is saying to Timothy, son, hold strong. Take hold of eternal life. Don't let anybody teach against it. You got it by grace. You got it by grace, and you got it at salvation. You cannot lose it because it belongs to God. Listen, this struggle is immediate for baby believers. You probably don't remember when you first got saved and somebody... If you didn't have the assurance of your salvation, then you were all over the place. Oh, God, I don't know if I'm going to... You know, you could be driving along and there's somebody, all of a sudden you hear a crash or something, your heart stops, you think, oh, if I was to die today, I'm not sure I'd go to heaven or go to hell. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I think I'm saved, but I don't know. I don't know. Remember those days? Quit it. You're listening to the enemy. Destroy your basis of faith. You can never grow if you're insecure in your salvation. 1 Peter 2:2. You've got to grow in respect to your salvation where you're not always cringing at the sound of something that thinks in your life that that would somehow remove you from eternal life. Like newborn babes long for the pure milk of the word, so that by it you may grow in respect to salvation. Let me tell you, this is a big deal. This is a big deal. In 1 Peter, the first chapter, I read 2:2. In 1 Peter 1:23, it says that the word of God that you got born again by, the gospel, the word of God, the gospel part of it, that you were born again by, he says, is the imperishable seed of a living, enduring word of God. The very word that saves you is eternal. Not just your salvation is eternal, but the word that you believed is eternal. You know the one book in the library in heaven? one book in the library of heaven, the B-I-B-L-E.
Well, I think I'll go down to the library today and read.
You better like the Bible, because the rest of the foolishness is not going to make it. One book from Earth. One book from the library of Earth. One book. I don't even know if they have it at UAB. That was the one book I checked out of UAB when I was there. The Bible walked around the campus like any other book. I didn't know it wasn't the right thing to do until after I got saved. Then somebody said, you're not going to take care of the Bible, are you, to the co-op, where the teens went, where we all went and ate. You're not going to take the Bible with you, are you? It's just a book. Take the Bible everywhere with me. I'd rather have the Bible than a spare tire. I can get more done with the Bible than you can with a spare tire. Here's the second thing. Eternal life is given to every church-age believer the moment he believes that Jesus died for his sins, was buried, and raised from the dead on the third day. If you hear nothing else from me today, hear that. You think you're going to slide through here? You think you're going to slide through here?
Well, you know, most of the time I'm a good person. Most of the time.
Yeah, most of the time ain't going to get you into heaven, though. Listen to me. You know why God brought you here today? So that you could get this thing settled in your life, so that you could take hold of it and have the good confession of that confession of eternal life, of assurance to other people. That's why I'm here today. It's exactly why I'm here today. And this is why I'm passionate about it. This is why I'm passionate about it. I'm passionate for my own, but I'm passionate that you have settled on it and that your friends get settled on it, because you got the confession of a good confession about it. Listen, here's John 3:36. Here's John 3:36. He who believes in the Son, he's talking about Jesus Christ, has eternal life. Well, you got to believe something about the Son. What about the Son? See, nobody asks that until you, like an unbeliever like me. I said, well, who is this Son you're talking about? Well, we're talking about Jesus. Well, who is Jesus? I thought it was a swear word. Now what are you going to do with a guy like me? When you read a verse like that and you say, well, it's the Son. And I go, like, Son of who? And it says, the Son of God. What's his name? Jesus Christ. And I say to you, I thought that was a swear word. Now what are you going to do? I'll tell you what most of them did. They picked up the Bible and walked away because they thought I was an idiot. I really meant that. They didn't know Jesus was a real person. What are you going to do with a guy like me talking all that stuff around the bush? What are you going to do with me? I don't know what all that stuff is. Most people got irritated me, walked away from me until I met one person and said, well, let me explain it to you. Then I went to the library and checked out a Bible. Find out for myself. Listen, he who believes in the Son has eternal life, but he who does not obey the Son, that's what he has to do to be saved, will not see life, but the wrath of God remains on him. Remains on him. Don't talk while I'm talking. Do not talk when I'm talking. You can hold it. Romans 5:21. So that as in sin reigned in death. Now watch the word as and even so. Watch this now. As sin reigned in death. That's at Romans 5:12 business. But I'm in verse 21. As sin reigned in death, even so grace would reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus through. Look at the word through. It's used twice. You're missing it. You're not paying attention to me today. As sin reigned in death, reigned. That's a monarchy. Reign. I'm not talking about water. I'm talking about a monarchy. Reigned. Like a king. As sin reigned in death, so grace will reign. You see, we've changed monarchies. How did that change occur in my life? Through my faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now watch the words through. Through. So grace would reign through righteousness. Through righteousness. It's not my righteousness. It's the righteousness imputed to me. To eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. There is a mechanism. Salvation, righteousness, eternal life through Jesus Christ. That is the only way. It's the only way. I get in these verses, I've given you other verses to study on your own. It'd be beneficial to your personal life. I don't read them all. Listen, if you don't care about it, this says something about you. If the only time you ever pick up a Bible is when you come to this church, that's the only time you ever pick up a Bible, that's a sad commentary on your life. Because I give you enough here. I give you enough. This is a doggy bag. It's a doggy bag. I give eternal life to them. I give eternal life to them, John 10, 28. I give. You ought to circle that. Yeah, you know, Jesus says, I give. I give eternal life. I give eternal life to them. They will never perish. You know why? Because he gives eternal life to them. Listen, that's an absolute. We live in such a day where people don't believe in absolutes. They lied to themselves because everybody believes in absolutes. When they say, I don't believe in absolutes, they're lying to themselves. That's the worst deception of ever. But listen, he said, I give eternal life to them. Because I give eternal life to them, they can never perish. Once you get eternal life, see, you're perishing before it, John 3:16. You're perishing before you get eternal life. Once you believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, perishing is gone, eternal life is in, and it's always in. There'll never be a day in your life when it's not in. Yes. Is eternal life home? You betcha. He's always home. My goodness, people. No one. You ought to circle that. No one. You know what no one is? No one. Right? Aren't you glad that your dad didn't name you no one? Or nobody? They took a little respect for us, didn't they, Gary, when they didn't call us nobody? This is my son, nobody. I'm not surprised it wasn't called that. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. The Father and I are one. I give them, he holds them. Nobody can fold them. You need to read that. You see, at salvation, you enter the finished work of salvation the moment you believe. Listen. For by grace, Ephesians 2, 8, 9. For by grace are you saved through faith. And not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest you should boast. But let me tell you, after you get saved, you ought to boast all the time. that I got saved by grace. You ought to boast all the time. That's the good confession. You ought to boast all the time about it. You ought to boast all the time about it. Three, there's a doctrinal, that's it. I want you to get this. I want you to get this. Point three is very important because people don't pay any attention to this stuff. Let me tell you. I spoke to a teenager the other day. Sent to me by her mama, which is okay. I'll put you at ease. She didn't go to my church. Probably got some mamas ought to bring to me, but. I said to her, why are you here? My mother made me come. Well, I said, how do you feel about that? Well, I'm pretty mad, pretty disgusted. I said, could you go? I was at my office. I said, could you go to the restroom and come back? She can check herself out, right? Is there something wrong? I said, yeah. I think it would be good. I think everybody, probably everybody in the whole place would appreciate it. She said, well, tell me what it is. And I said, well, go in there and look in the mirror and come back. I mean, I won't tell you. She went to the bathroom, came back, sat down. She said, I couldn't find anything wrong. I said, well, that's the problem. You came in here with a miserable attitude and didn't even know it. It seems to be just normal stuff for you. But I can tell you, I noticed it. I went, whoa. There's an attitude. Whoa. I said, other people probably saw it when you walked through the door like a cowboy into a saloon. Knock those bar doors off. I said, look, I didn't invite you, but I'm here to help you. So, if you want to talk to me, if you want to just hang out and be a buddy with me today for a while, I'd like that. But you got to check that attitude, man. Got to go back to the bathroom and come back or something. When's your mama coming back? Well, she said she'd come back in about 30 minutes. Well, you got a deck of cards or something? Because all I got is a Bible. You know what it's about? Her mama makes her go to church. And she don't want to go to church. Well, I said, what would you rather do Sunday morning? Well, I'd rather do most anything, go to church. Okay. Tell me why you... And so we went in a long discussion, which is not important. When her mother came, I told her mother, go over there, sit down, and have a Coke. Because we're going to be here a while longer. Do you know what happened? Her mother got irritated with me. Her mother got irritated with me because I was dealing now with a young woman who was willing to open up and talk with me and checked her attitude off. And now I got one with her mother where I know the daughter got it. Now the mother's got an attitude towards me because I'm trying to fix a kid. Screwy. That's our society today. Screwing a bed bug. Now there's a distinction here. There's a distinction here between spiritual life and eternal life that you need to know the difference. There is a difference theologically. There is an important distinctive difference. Aren't you glad you came? In the pamphlet of 50 things that we give to people that talk about what a great salvation you have through grace, if you go back and look at that, you will see that I did something to separate these. I put spiritual life under one of the 8 works of the Holy Spirit, and I put eternal life under one of the 20 status privileges because they're distinctly different. Now, when I tell you why they are, you'll go like, ding, ding, I could have had a V8. It was one of those V8, that's a drink. Somebody was getting excited because they thought I was referring to an automobile. Listen, spiritual life, now listen to me, this is going to ring a bell now. Spiritual life is based on the ministry of the indwelling Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3. That's spiritual life. That's spiritual life. If you want the dynamics of it, oh yeah, you get it as salvation because it's one of 50 things, but it's the work of the Holy Spirit. Spirituality is the work of the Holy Spirit. Spiritual life is the work of the Holy Spirit. It's manifesting that life through your flesh. Isn't that wonderful? Your flesh. Make sure all the boys and girls see that when they look at you and do that double look. You know that double look? They walk through the room, take the oxygen out of it in your life. You remember that? You're just glad to have oxygen, right? Right. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20, the Holy Spirit dwells in you, and His job is to produce the spiritual life in you. Listen to me, it's not in your paper, so write down 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 3, and take a look at that, because you're spiritual because the Holy Spirit dwells in there, and He manifests spirituality. You're a spiritual person. When you're walking in the Spirit, He's able to manifest that through your flesh, through your body life. Spiritual death is contrasted in 1 Corinthians 15, 22 to spiritual death. Paul talks about it in 2 Corinthians 2, 14, 15 by the word smell. He contrasted these two things by smell. The stench of death and the sweet aroma of a fragrant perfume. Or dead fish. I mean, however, you know, however you want to think about it. The unsaved is contrasted with the saved based on the Holy Spirit in Romans 8, 9 through 11, Jude 19. Romans 8, 9 says, if you don't have the Holy Spirit, you don't belong to Christ. You're not saved. And if you are saved, then Christ is in you because of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's ministry. His job is to manifest that. Then when it comes to eternal life, see, eternal life is based on personal faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. John 5:40, the moment believe, you get eternal life. You've crossed over from spiritual death into spiritual life. You have eternal life. You have eternal life. Here's one for you. 1 John 2:25. You ought to circle that. Because this, listen, for me it was John 10, 28 through 30. I got that verse. I hung on to that verse that I have eternal life. Eternal life is in Jesus. Jesus is in God. Nobody can get Him out of their hands. I went, good for me. That's a strong man idea. That's a strong man idea. Nobody can pry it open. All the king's men and all the king's horses. See, that worked for me, but if it didn't, then I've got one for you. 1 John 2:25, it says eternal life is promised by God. It says eternal life is a promise from God. You have eternal life through Jesus Christ. It's a promise from God. And if you know anything about God, God has veracity. God cannot lie. Hebrews 6:18. God says, I give first John 5:11-13, eternal life is in Jesus. If you have Jesus, you have eternal life. How do I know for sure? Because the Bible says so. God made a promise to you. God promised it to you. God cannot lie. That's an absolute. That's an absolute. Paul and Barnabas, on their first missionary trip, were making the good confession about eternal life. They were in a Jewish synagogue, and they made confession of the good confession. It says, Paul and Barnabas spoke out boldly, said, it was necessary that the word of God has been spoken to you Jews first, since you repudiate it and judge yourself unworthy of eternal life. Behold, we're turning to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles went nuts. They went, hoo-ah! Or something like that. Yeah. The Gentiles got mad with excitement, and the Jews got angry with incitement. There's a difference there, wasn't there? Yeah. Look, don't go preach that stuff here. Maybe you feel that way as you sit here today. Don't preach that stuff here. When the Gentiles heard Paul's message, they began rejoicing and glorifying the word of the Lord, and as many as has been appointed to, and this word tasso means appointed, means to a place in order, a place in order. Potasso is like standing in regiments under review. You know, A company, B company, C company, that business. That's what that means. When the Gentiles saw that, they rejoiced the word of God, because as many as has been appointed and placed in their order, their dispensational order, or in their order of time in the plan of God, to eternal life believed. And the word of the Lord was being spread throughout the whole region. You know why? Because the Gentiles took it on. I'll tell you something that's missed, that most people miss, in this idea of Aimee plus Tasso. I know I'm probably overstretching my time with you here, but listen, Aimee is an imperfect tense, and appointed is a perfect tense. Now listen, in the Greek language, when you have Aimee as an imperative, as an imperfect, and you have tasso as perfect, it automatically elevates the perfect tense up into a pluperfect. That's a unique deal in the Greek language. It elevates it. It takes perfect into another realm. Oh, you're missing it. It is so good, and I can't help it. See, perfect tense, listen. The perfect tense means that it's completed in the past or results or remains completed forever. You understand that? He's talking about eternal life, right? Appointed to what? Come on now, eternal life. The pluperfect takes this out of earth and puts it in third heaven. It knocks this thing out of the ballpark. It's still a perfect tense, but it's been elevated to a pluperfect. I mean, he has just pushed this thing out of the realm of man into the realm of God. You know why you have eternal life, and that eternal life is secured? Because of God Almighty. That is so good. That's worth every penny you give me right there. As many as were being placed in order, in the order of eternal life believed. That's what 1346 says. Oh, my goodness. Well, I got to quit. I'm going to let you go to the bathroom now and check your attitude. So you go back second half. Let's have a word of prayer. The men will take the offering. If you're a visitor, don't worry about this. This meal has been paid for by the grace of God. We do this for our people. They give as God has purposed in their heart, and this is their opportunity. As a visitor, just relax. I'm going to ask Bill Morgan if he would have this offertory prayer.
The privilege and the opportunity once again to gather around the word of truth, pray that our hearts be encouraged, strengthened, and we might take over eternal life. Now, Father, Lord, we thank you for this offering. We praise you for thy glory and all things done. In Christ's name.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life.